So we come now to the last section of the lecture, and that is the section Influence of Material Inhomogeneities. We have, in the last section, we have seen that weak interfaces can have a significant role on the value of the fracture toughness. In general, also material inhomogeneities can have a very significant role on the fracture behavior of material. And that is the topic of research in the last 10, 15 years in our institute, in my research group. And one can show that special variations of material properties, for example, special variations of the Young's modulus, of the yield stress, of the strain-hardening exponent, and also special variations of the residual stress state can influence strongly the magnitude of the crash-driving force. And it can influence also the direction of crack propagation. And that effect is very important for all cracks in inhomogeneous materials, as we have seen in the last example of that ferritic, austenitic complex steel, for example. But also to all composites, composite material, and so on. And we can show that we can use that effect also to design new, especially fracture-resistant and damage-tolerant materials. I will here bring only a few slides. I have a lecture on nonlinear fracture mechanics, and there I will tell more details about that effect. Here are some experimental findings that are investigations of my colleague Reinhard Diepern and co-workers, and they have investigated the fatigue crack growth rate in immaterial specimens when one part of the specimen consists of a high-strength material and the other part of the specimen consists of a very low-strength material, that is armcore iron. You see here the yield strength of the steel is 530 megapascal, that of armcore iron 140 megapascal. And here is plotted now the fatigue crack propagation rate dependent on the distance to the interface between the two type of materials. And experiments were conducted at different stress intensity range values. What you see in general is that the crack propagation rate is rather constant when the material, when the crack tip is very far from the interface, then the crack propagation rate decreases first and then increases directly in front of the crack tip, and then the crack crosses the interface and has a crack growth rate has an approximately constant value. For the lowest delta K value, the crack even stopped in front of the interface and didn't propagate any longer. That was for what we call transition hard soft. The crack is located in, first in the hard material and propagates to the soft material. Now that is for transition soft hard. The crack is located in the soft material, in proper case to the direction of the hard material. And what you see here is that the crack growth rate in generally slightly increases in front of the interface, and then it drops significantly. And two of the three specimens, the crack, the deep crack didn't propagate through the interface. Only for the lowest delta K value, the crack propagated through the interface and increased after the interface again. And so you can see that effect of material inhomogeneity in experiments. We have made also many experiments in our group to confirm that. In general, we can say that usually you know that in a homogeneous material, the J integral is path independent, and that means that J tip, the J integral around the crash tip, equals J far. And in an inhomogeneous material, that equation is not valid anymore. We have an equation J tip equals J far plus C inhomogeneity. In fact, C inhomogeneity is called material inhomogeneity term. And you can consider J tip as the crack driving force. J far is the driving force that is inserted by the applied load into the specimen. And C inhomogeneity is a driving force component that is produced by the material inhomogeneity. Now you can easily understand if C inhomogeneity is larger than zero, if that is positive, J tip is larger than J far. That means we have an anti-shielding effect. The crack tip feels a higher crack driving force as it would feel in a homogeneous material. If that material in homogeneity term is negative, we have a shielding effect of the material in homogeneity. That means the crack driving force is lower than the driving force inserted into the specimen by the applied load or the driving force in a homogeneous material. And by experiments and analytical and finite element evaluations, you can find that the material inhomogeneity term is positive if the crack crosses from a material with a high Young's modulus into a material with a low Young's modulus. That means we have a transition stiff to compliant, and the crack grows into a more compliant material. Seeing homogeneity is also positive if the crack grows from a high strength to a low strength material. That means if the yield stress decreases in propagation, crack propagation rate. Or if the strain hardening material decreases in the crack propagation rate. On the other hand, you have a shielding effect. If the crack grows from a material with low Young's modulus to a material with high Young's modulus, if a crack propagates into a higher strength material or a higher hardening material. Okay? Good. We have one big deal of that research was started by a colleague, a former institute director, Peter Fraxel, who is now in Potsdam at the Max Planck Institute, and he is investigating the behavior of many natural biological materials. And there are many biological materials that have very remarkable material properties. For example, there are deep sea sponges, and they live in the ocean at the sea level of, say, 800 to 300 meters. And they form skeletons. And these skeletons consist mainly of glass. It's a bio glass, but it contains only from silicon dioxide. Yeah? And you know that glass is a very brittle material. It's one of the most brittle materials. So that skeleton of the glass sponges consists of 90 or 95% of the brittle glass, but they have a very high fracture toughness and fracture resistance. And the reason why that is so is the glass layers are very thin, and between the glass layers there are protein layers. And the protein layers can be considered like a glue, and that act as crack stoppers. And the Young's modulus of that material is of the glass is approximately 40 gigapascal, and that Young's modulus of that protein interlayers is very low, of the order of 1 gigapascal, and so you have a significant decrease and significant variation of the Young's modulus. And so the crack can grow very easily into the soft interlayer, into the protein interlayer, but then it is trapped there and cannot grow further. And that is the reason why that creatures have such a high fracture resistance. We have tried now to adopt that idea and build engineering materials that can use or utilize that material in homogeneity effect. And what we did is we connected a very high strength materials. It's a cold working steel C45. It has a yield strength of 1700 megapascal. And we connected it with thin layers of an interstitial-free steel that has a very low yield strength of approximately 400 megapascal square root of meter. So the ratio of the yield strength between the high strength and low strength materials is approximately a factor 4, and you see that interlayers have a thickness of approximately 100 micrometer. And the effect is now very significant. If we have a homogeneous material specimen of the C45, have a fracture initiation toughness of the order of 11 kilojoule per square meter. And the crack propagates now very easily and propagates into that soft interlayer. Saying we get a tremendous increase in fracture toughness, and the specimen fails at a critical J value of more than 3,000 kilojoules per square meter. So we have a tremendous increase in fracture toughness due to the soft interval. Okay? Yeah, and you can hear more, much more about that effect in the next lecture that I will have in 1 year. I hope I can make a normal lecture and not a video lecture next year. Okay. So thank you for your attention.